a lot of people express through just their words, just expressing their words. Some people express through artwork. Some other people express it with actions. But some people express it with poetry. And there is a long history of amazing poets from anywhere in the in Latin America. There is a lot of Mexican poets, and or I know about an Argentinian poet, and I just fell in love with Hispanic or Latinx poetry. And today's event, we are going, you know, highlighting some of these new poets as well as our own poets from our campuses. So welcome to our event, and let's get started. So just reflecting back to our past events, you know, we had our voter registration rally featuring Dolores Huerta, and one thing that stuck with me was that, you know, about 30,000 Latinos, or I believe it was Hispanics who were Mexicans that were living here, they were killed back in the 1950s. So that stuck with me, and that's something that, you know, impacted history. And then the Hispanic and Latinx and its terminology, you know, we talked about how some of us might identify as Hispanic, or as Latinx, as Chicano, Chicanx. So that's another thing that impacts our own community. COVID, we talked about race and the census, how we have to identify as white in the census, and some of us are not okay with that. We don't feel comfortable with that, but we had a talk about that, right? DIY Piñata on Instagram Live. I love piñatas. I am too short. You can't see it, but I'm too short to, like, you know, hit it all the way over there. I have to jump up, but yeah, so we have that event as well. We have the live, the performance artist Christian Cruz, and our salsas event as well. I don't know if y'all remember, but then I got home and I was like, okay, let me make some salsas now. Just about 2 days ago, we had the Javier Avila show with My Name, the one-man show, and that really hit home because, you know, Hispanics, sometimes whenever we go to, you know, places, whether it's a professional setting or whether it's, you know, with meeting new people, it's always, you know, a trouble to say our names. Like, my last name is Cindy, and that's easy to say, but my last name is Favela, and I get called Fabula, Fabulous, Fabila, and it's a little bit, you know, complicated for us sometimes. So thinking back and reflecting back to those events and how they made us feel, how we think about it, I just want you to, you know, I just want us to begin with that mindset, so that we can, you know, we're going to open it up to whatever you think, and you can share your thoughts with us. And so let's get started. And we're going to watch a video. Let's see. So this video is, we're going to be sharing some videos about some poetry that has to do with Hispanics and our struggles sometimes, or, you know, what we feel sometimes. So let's watch this video.
Standing amongst the dirt and the barbed wires, the faceless crosses lay across its rusty surface.
A la frontera.
A la pared. Running from the Pacific to the Gulf. a silent cry from those who walk in scorching hot suns by day and below zero temperatures by night, with only a gallon of water and a prayer in their pocket, hoping both will last. At the shore, Tabasco, 1519. La leyenda de la pared, the legend of the wall, begins with those who arrived wearing silver skin, who enslaved the aboriginals, and those brought on cargo ships, who created a system where the deeper the melanin, the deeper the slashes, ingrains pain into the minds of their kin, white backs burdened with the mounds of gold at the expense of el indígena y la africana. Borders created at the Treaty of Hidalgo constructed a wall to separate us from them. On the television screen, everywhere, United States, 2016. He says a nation without a wall is not a nation, as he envisions it spread across 55 feet of poles concrete smeared in hues of red, white, and blue. Because spending $14.4 billion on border enforcement is not enough. Having thermal sensors that detect the heat coming off of panting figures is not enough. Shooting hollow point bullets expanding at the impact of human flesh is not enough. Operation Gatekeeper, San Diego, Operation Safeguard, Tucson, Operation Hold the Line, El Paso are not enough. A woman holds up a poster with the words, illegals get everything and we get nothing. Working from sunrise to sundown for less than $2 an hour in 100 degree weather, getting everything. Walking 10 to 20 miles by Los Paleteros, who walked hundreds of miles across the border, getting everything. Standing in the corners of MacArthur Park, selling mangos con chile by Los Fruteros, getting everything. Ignoring the backs of Los Jardineros, begging their spines to realign with their ribs. Waking up before the sun does to pull out weeds of a yard that'll never be theirs, getting everything. A man yells, it is not fair to let the illegals stay here. He says, as millions cut out their Spanish tongues and close the veins that flow back to their gente, the 1940 bracero still carries my abuelo's fingerprints in the soil of Oxnard, bringing thousands of Mexicanos to work in los campos of El Norte for more than they were used to, for less than they deserve. My tío's copper skin still lingers with the scent of DDT, sprayed along his bare brazos that pick the fruit that is set on your mahogany tables as a centerpiece. At the wall, U.S.-Mexican border, Texas, 2020. A la frontera,
a la pared.
Faceless crosses erased from its gleaming surface.
Replaced with hues of red, white, and blue.
55 feet of cold concrete that runs from the Pacific to the Gulf.
And a cheer from those who used to grouse.
Joyous.
Relieved.
Grateful. And a silenced cry from those who used to walk.
Hoping their water and prayers will last.
Tell us your dishonored names and we will testify. Aquí descansa.
Aquí descansa.
Aquí descansa.
Aquí descansa.
Oye, listen.
Wow, so that that poem really hit me. I think it relates a lot to what's going on right now. You know, the current issues, children in cages, and how we are just, you know, separated from the beginning and separated from our families, and how, you know, our ancestors had to come here to the U.S. and, you know, work hard and harder than a lot of people. And, you know, it really shows how hardworking Latinos are, how hurtful it can be. It's just a wall, but it has a lot of power. I want to open it up to anyone who has any comments. You can unmute yourselves or raise your hand, and I'll open it up to y'all if y'all have anything to say about anything that we talk about, because these are current issues and this is very powerful. Yes, it was very powerful to me, and I personally didn't go through that, but I know of a lot of people, and it causes a lot of pain. Does anyone have any comments? All right, so the next person is going to share with us a poem Angie.
Hi, everyone. Can you all hear me?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. So the poem that I'm going to be reading is one that I resonate to. As I read it, this is basically how my childhood was. I did not write this poem. I actually just found it, and I've actually been knowing about this poem for quite some time because I came across it on the internet. And when I read it, it like definitely explained how I grew up. Whoever wrote it is actually from East Los Angeles, but we know it as East Los. I do have family in California who used to live there, but now live in Azusa, California, which is, you know, predominantly Mexican-American. So I'm going to go ahead and begin to read it. So the poem is called Where I Am From. I was raised in East Los Angeles, Boyle Heights. However, my roots are from Santiago Papasquiaro, Durango, Mexico. I am from Mexican culture proudly displayed on every corner of my barrio, from the corner liquor stores to the local panaderias that sell pan dulce that you could smell at the break at dawn. I am from neighbors blasting corridos while drinking cold cerveza and making carne asada that you could smell a block away. I am from a small pueblo in Santiago Papasquiaro with the legend of La Llorona and a river that flows from the back of my father's grandparents' house to my mother's grandparents' house. I am from stables and horses to maize being grown in the fields, to block party fiestas on September 11th and honoring the dead on Dia de los Muertos in November. I am from waking up at the break at dawn in the summers to help my grandmother feed the cows, the pigs, the chickens, and horneando la vaca for milk and looking for eggs in the chicken hen. I am from the small pueblo that values familia, tradiciones, y celebrando la vida. I am from a child with multiple families living in one house, from uncles that helped my mother take care of me, and from fond memories in Holland Bend Park. I am from eating raspados in the vanilla con lechera at the park while watching my brothers ride their bikes around the lake. I am from the street St. Louis where my childhood began, to out in Beas and Holland Bend Youth Center. I am from all of the East Los Angeles Boyle Heights. Nevertheless, my journey began on the corner of St. Louis and First Street, across from the local branch. I am from the 99 cent store to the Mariscos truck, located two blocks from my new home at 2nd and Breed Street. I am from family gathering on sábados y domingos for carne asada, tamales recién hechos en la mañana, and hot chocolate and champurrado my dad makes. On the cold winter mornings, I am from a backyard located across from my elementary school, to bautizos, quinceañeras, y cumpleaños that have been celebrated in the same backyard. I am from my local high school, Roosevelt, that is only a 10-minute walk from my house. I am from the crowded hallways and limited resources offered due to budget cuts. I am from student council to the 4x4, the 400 and the triple jump, to the tennis courts and volleyball courts. I am from the inspirational teachers like Mr. Gibbs and Ms. Gutierrez to counselors like Mr. Sutherland that made sure I was in AP and honors classes. I am from a school that has transformed over the years to better accommodate my Mexican and Mexican-American community. I am from my mother, Maria Socorro Garcia Carrasco, whose grandchildren call her Piña, and to my father, David Torres Carrasco, who I call Apa. I am from five brothers and three sisters who do not always get along, nevertheless value each other and care for one another. I am from a generation and cultural gap between my older siblings who are now married and two younger brothers who live at home with my parents. I am from waking up early on weekends to go to the marqueta with my apa, to helping my mom make tamales gorditas y tortillas de harina con frijoles on holidays. Now I am from a house that my parents can call their own, whose walls are filled with noise of laughter, crying and arguing. I am from my family visiting on weekends, waiting for homemade cooking, to nieces and nephews playing in the backyard while we cook, chile rellenos, enchiladas de pollo y carne adobado in the kitchen. I am from a house that has never experienced true silence and never will because of the constant laughter, crying, arguing that are within the walls. I am from mi apa, mi ama, Patricia, Nicolas, Juan, Angel, Marta, Yvette, Francisco, and Junior, who will always be my family. I am from strong morals from saying apa,
La educación es lo más importante, to my mamá saying, que Dios te bendiga, pórtate bien, mija. Every time I leave home, I am from East Los Angeles, Boyle Heights, whose culture is infused in me. I am from my parents who have supported my decisions, to my mom tearing up every time I leave home. I am from mi barrio, mi cultura mexicana, mi familia. So like I said, this poem really resonates to how I grew up. It is definitely every moral, every tradition that we hold, every plate that we eat. And although I know that it was Spanglish, that is literally who I am. I sometimes forget my English and I sometimes forget my Spanish, but somehow they intertwine with one another. And that's how sometimes I speak. Even sometimes at work when I'm at meetings, I'd be like, pero, instead of saying, but. And so it's just those different things that I resonate with. And I hope that you all enjoy this poem as much as I did.
So, as Angie was sharing her poem, it was crazy because it starts talking about her her hometown, and that is my hometown. And I you know, I was like, oh, wow, you know, I had a different upbringing. I grew up in Mexico. I grew up in my hometown, and somehow I can already identify with everything that I'm reading, because even though I didn't grow up here in the United States, I still grew up, you know, in that same environment in a way. And I feel like that's what the poem is talking about, how, you know, there's a certain environment that you surround yourself with, and it's called, you know, your familia, your family. And sometimes we call our familia as well, like our friends, our group of friends. And I don't know if anyone has any anything to share, but that was, you know, that hit home, like literally home. Yes, it's a beautiful herencia poem. It talks about, you know, something that resonated a lot with me was my mom always tells me, you know, your education is the most important thing for you, because, you know, that way you can keep moving forward from anything. And that's something that my grandpa used to say to my mom, and it's something that really stuck with me. And and if anyone needs to hear it, your education is important. La educación es muy importante. And it just shares a lot of family values and a lot of, you know, amazing experiences that growing up as Hispanic, Latino, Chicano, Chicana, it just gives a lot of feeling, you know. And Jessica says, such a beautiful poem, and it reminds me of my family from my hometown of Santiago Marabatío, Guanajuato. Amazing. So now I'm going to open it up to anyone. If anyone wants to share anything, you can share anything about, you know, all the topics that we've hit so far. It's open mic time. If anyone, you know, has to share anything, y'all can raise your hand, y'all can unmute yourselves, and we'll let you speak. You don't have to turn on your camera or anything, but the floor is yours if you want to share anything. Next slide. All right, so this is a video that, you know, just listen to it. This is amazing to me, and I can really like identify with everything that she says. So let's listen to this video.
Y
If you ask me if I am fluent in Spanish, I will tell you my Spanish is an itchy phantom limb. It is reaching for words and only finding air. My Spanish is my third birthday party. Half of it is memory. The other half is that photograph on the fridge is what my family has told me. My Spanish is puzzle, left in the rain, too soggy to make its parts fit together to look just like the picture on the box. My Spanish is possessive adjectives. It is proper nouns dressed in pearls and bracelets. It is, are you up yet? It is, there is a lot of work to do today. My Spanish is on my resume as a skill. My Spanish is on my toothbrush and red mouth marks. My Spanish is so hungry. My Spanish reaches for words at the top of a shelf with no stepping stool. Is hit in the head with all of the words that I've been hiding up there. My Spanish wonders if it's bad to eat something that's expired. My Spanish wonders if it has an expiration date. My Spanish asks you why it's always being compared to food. Es spicy, hot, sizzle. My Spanish wants to let you know it is not something to be eaten and then shit out, but does not really believe it. My Spanish. If you ask me if I am fluent in Spanish, I'll tell you my Spanish sits in the corner of a classroom, chews on a pencil, does not raise its hand. My Spanish is my sister's sore smile at her only beauty pageant. My Spanish is a made-up story about a parent who never came home. My Spanish is a made-up story about a parent who never came home but traveled to beautiful countries, sent me postcards from all of them. My Spanish is me, tracing every letter they were able to fit in. My Spanish is true story of my parents' divorce, chaotic, broken. Something I have to choose to remember correctly. My Spanish is asking me if my parents are American, asking me if I'm white yet. My Spanish. If you ask me if I am fluent in Spanish, I'll try to tell you a story of how my parents met in an ESL class, how it was when they trained their mouths to say, I love you in a different language, I hate you with their mouths shut. I'll tell you how my father's accent makes him sound like Zorro, how my mother tried to tie her tongue to a post with an English language leash, how the tongue always ran stubbornly back to the language it had always been in love with. Even when she tried to tame it, it always turned loose. My Spanish is understanding there are stories that will always be out of my reach. There are people who will never fit together the way that I wanted them to. There are letters that will always stay silent. There are words that will always escape me.
So this just blew my mind because I, whenever she says my Spanish is sitting in the corner of the classroom, biting on her pencil, scared to raise their hand, that really, like, it just, like, stuck with me because that was me. I came to the U.S. whenever I was in fourth grade, and I was in an ESL class, and I just, you know, I didn't speak English. I spoke Spanish, and although I felt comfortable in a bilingual class in fifth grade, I got moved to a class full English, and that's whenever it all started. You know, that's whenever I was sitting in the corner biting on my pencil. And even in high school, I was the type who would never participate, who would never raise their hand because her accent, people will make fun of your accent. And it just doesn't talk about your Spanish, like the language, it talks much deeper into it. It talks about how expired milk, how it wonders if the milk is expired. And that's something, I don't know if it's, I feel like it is Latin culture that it's like, oh, like that is expired. And sometimes, you know, we pay attention a lot to those things. Sometimes the date doesn't really matter. And I ask my parents and it's like, well, you know, it doesn't smell bad. So, you know, you can keep drinking it. It doesn't smell that bad. And like this expiration date was like 2 days ago. And I just think it's such a beautiful poem. And if anyone has any comments about this, or if anyone can identify with anything that she said, you can, again, you can unmute yourselves. I am okay with that. And you can share anything that, you know, you want to share. Yes, it's just an amazing poem. So we're going to go to the next slide. And following up with that, I made my own poem, and I just came up with this because I didn't know how to express. I couldn't find anything that could express anything that I've been through, because I wasn't an immigrant, but I, you know, I've seen, you know, the issues in my own family. So my poem is titled 25, and I'm Cindy Favela. So every September 13th, I turn a year older. Every year that passes by, she remembers the last time she crossed the border. It happens every year as I sit on the get together eating my carne asada. I think about the questions I am bound to hear. The question that I don't want to disregard and answer, nada. This year, as she gave me a gift card, my tia asked, "How old are you turning?" I am just thinking, is it really that hard? And through her eyes about her struggles, I am learning. She talks and laughs about life, as if she didn't miss her mom and dad every night. When they didn't get to go to be there when she became a wife, and she wasn't there when her father died. I turned 25, I say, as I know what comes next. It's been that long since she came to fight. She came to give her family the opportunity that seemed best. I go back every other year to my hometown. The clouds are bigger, the stars are shinier, the moon is brighter, the people are happier, the air is cleaner, the houses are fuller, and the weather is nicer. She has missed out on the smell of the leña burning at nights, and the warmth of the people every morning, just to come to this country to fight, but she did it sweeping and mopping. She came to a country with no inglés, with no other option but to clean the white girl's house. But today I see a smile on her face and her happiness to see my grandmother every morning in her house. I turned 25, I say, and she tells me that's how long I've been in the USA. My aunt, she came to the US whenever, you know, I was just a newborn, and she remembers, you know, with my age, she remembers when she came to chase the American dream. And it's something that I kind of wanted to, you know, share with y'all, because it's something that I didn't personally go through, but it's something that she went through, you know, cleaning houses. And she's always, you know, tired but never complaining. I always see her and my mom as well. She doesn't speak English, but she's learning. She's being really good. Like I'm teaching her a lot of things, but she doesn't have the confidence because, again, you know, we are ashamed to speak Spanish. And Does anyone have any comments? Yes, I've shared my story today. So next up, we have a student of ours who decided to share her poems. We have Beatriz Acosta. She is going to be sharing some poems of hers. This is going to open up a conversation or any poems that you want to share. These are of her own. She's Latinx. She is Hispanic. If you want to share, Beatriz, how you identify, if you identify as Hispanic, Latinx, Chicana, that would be amazing.
Yeah, so I like to say that I identify as all. When someone of a different race asks me, you know, are you Chicana? Are you Latina? I just say yes to everything. I feel like we are, or myself, am a representation of, you know, Latinx, Latina, Chicana. So I have no saying, yeah, you know, I identify as all. But thank you for this time. These are poems that I wrote. And I love writing poems. My first language was, you know, Spanish, and I didn't know how to, you know, speak English or write English. My third grade English teacher, he took the time to invest in me after school. And so now I love writing poems and using big words. And so I'm going to read one in English and then the other one, a different one in Spanish. So the first one is titled Tired Wife. And it goes like this. You sink your teeth into my skin, counting the times I breathe, memorizing every heartbeat I skip, dissected and isolated. A thorny throne becomes my home, a lifelong trial where no verdict exists. I reshape my smile to fit your mood. Being your oxygen becomes my suffocation. You hold my marionette. Providing your needs becomes my affliction. And I actually rewrote the second one in Spanish. So I'm going to go ahead and read it in Spanish, but she's got it up there in English, so that's great. Thank you for that. La Jezebel en mí. Compartiste con la madre de todas las traiciones. Bebiste de la copa sin retorno. Luchas por encontrar el sueño. Tus pecados te despellejan viva. Atormentada día y noche, se encadenan alrededor de tu cuello. Jadeas por más aire. La ansiedad tensa el cuello día y noche. Caes de rodillas pidiendo perdón a un Dios que no puedes ver. And these are the only two that I have.
That was amazing.
Thank you.
Yes. If you look at the chat, people are clapping, and I'm clapping too. That was amazing. I think it's beautiful when someone gets inspired like that and is able to express those words. I am a person who does simple words, and your words are just amazing and inspiring. And thank you so much, Beatriz, for sharing that with us. Thank you for sharing what really, like, it comes from the heart. It comes from within us. So if anyone wants to share anything, Hannah said those were amazing. Jessica said they're really good. Angie said she has a lot more. Y'all. Oh, I think my computer froze. Okay, there you go. She said, Angie said she has a lot more. Y'all are great. Y'all, they are great. Thank you, Beatrice, for sharing. Head to the comments, y'all. Leave your comments below. And if anyone has anything to share, any comments, any poems that they like to share, I love Frida Kahlo and her poems. If anyone has to share any poems, it doesn't have to be about, being Hispanic in the U.S. It can be by someone Hispanic or Latinx. So now we're going to watch the last video, and we're going to conclude our event with this video. We can talk about it, and so this is our last video. And we just talked about our Spanish and, being from another country, and some other people identify as, something else, Let's watch it, and then we'll have a discussion about it.
The man's words to me are not offered, but flung. So, what are you? Where are you from? I say, New York. But your name is Carlos. I mean, where are you? I said, New York. Bueno, yo soy Latino. Mi padre es colombiano. Mi madre es estadounidense. Nací en New York City. I lived in 4 countries, moved 12 times, went to 12 schools before I graduated high school. It's not what I would say in 12,341 years, because I don't know a damn thing to anyone. What am I? What am I? A financial aid form, a vegan red velvet cupcake recipe? Dude discovers his first Latino with green eyes and suddenly appoints himself the authority on Latinidad. Like, but you totally don't look Mexican. Oh, Colombian. But like, what percentage are you? Do you speak it, though? Fluently, dance salsa well, oh, but not both parents. You've been there, but not lived there. She weren't born there. Yeah. I'm not a government questionnaire. I'm not an anecdote for your homogenous social gathering of your homogenous friends. I know everyone you hang out with looks like you, has a name you're able to pronounce and or share and or sounds pulled directly from an episode of Leave It to Beaver. Here's the deal. Latin America is not just Mexico. Actually pronounced Mexico, pero whatever. Central America is not part of South America, and Mexican is still not a language. The question, where are you from in our current America, is a slur disguised with a question mark. A passive-aggressive microaggression saying you are other, saying you are not from here, saying you are not nor will ever be one of us, saying go back to where you came from. But I am from a place beyond place. A place where once you're from there, you can never leave, because it exists beyond dirt and flesh, beyond your linear and limited concept of time. I am from bloodlines unkillable as water. I am the return that is only earned when absence has stretched its greedy void across a passage as stoic and sacred as an abuela's hard-edged love. I am my Black and Latina daughter's grace, chimered into the cobalt pulse of these once too often fists. I am a boy. Without a word of English in his mouth in a Catholic school classroom in South Florida. His son on a stage 58 years later tonight reading this poem for him. I am the steady ray of light unlocking my mother's teeth, tossed skyward in a laugh. What hard-earned joy looks like, carved from the wreckage of a lifetime's worth of grief. You are not ready for the answers to the questions you ask, not ready for the world these words might shake free. You could never understand what I am or where I am from.
So that, if they ask me, what am I? I say Mexican, but I know a lot of people who they say, I'm from Texas. And I'm like, okay, like, I understand. And sometimes we make that mistake, and sometimes we ask people, where are you really from? And we have to remember that they're from here. And, you know, some people are born here, some people are born in other countries. And something that really I identified with was that sometimes it seems a little bit passive aggressive, like you don't belong here. And, you know, that's something that I do feel whenever they ask me, where are you from? And even though I am from another country, it's, you know, when we talked about race, we talked about there's only one human race. And from here, from the earth, you know, you can say that. And with this, we conclude our Poetry From Our Roots event. I hope you have enjoyed it. I hope it did something to your heart. Whenever I was watching these videos for the first time, I did tear up a lot. And, you know, it just hit home. It hit on the heart. Yes. Yeah, so don't forget to fill out our assessment. And let me read the comments before I read the upcoming events. Maria, hi, how are you? excellent poems today. Thank you for making La Lucha so young. This elder Hispana is proud of all of you. Thank you. Thank you so much. Evangelina, education alleviates poverty. We are bigger than what we think. We need to pick our cause and be agents of change for the good. We must not stay in the corner chewing on our pencil. Yes. We need to learn how to get out of our comfort zone. That is so true. And that is something that, you know, I had to learn the hard way, because whenever I went to college, I had to get out of that corner, you know? And thank you for sharing your poems. Thank you for attending our event. Thank you for all of your comments and, you know, engaging in the conversations. I'm really glad that y'all are here. And just make sure that you, excuse me, you come to our Latin dance lessons. We are at noon. We are having these lessons, and they are awarding a full month of free classes. It can be salsa, bachata, cumbia, reggaeton, by the Kumbala dance studio. So please hop on here on Teams. It's the same team site, and we'll see y'all there. And it's right here. Thank you so much for attending today. So also, before I forget, the other events that we have, we're about to finish up our Hispanic Latinx Heritage Month. And the last event is going to be Diane Guerrero.
Tienen las flores, lloronas las flores de un campo santo, que cuando las mueve el viento, llorona parece. Están llorando, que cuando las mueve el viento, llorona. de frío.